So while today the main topic of discussions is multidimensional arrays, we are going to first continue our discussion on sorting. You remember the other day we looked at an algorithm which will take an array of numbers and sort them in ascending or descending order. And we gave an example of sorting marks in an examination. And we said how if we have an associated roll number array, then whenever you exchange any elements of the marks array, you must also exchange the corresponding element of the roll array so that the sorted arrays remain consistent with roll number and marks. Now you will recall that we had commented on the execution time taken by our sort algorithms. And we observed that if we increase the number of elements to be sorted by, let's say, twice the previous number, the execution time appeared to increase four times. It was essentially moving in proportion to the square of the size of the problem. At that time, we merely noted that and we said that there has to be a faster algorithm for doing sorting. There are actually many fast algorithms which do sorting better. One of them is called the merge sort. To understand the notion of merge sort, we are not going to discuss the merge sort algorithm today, but we are going to discuss a key problem in that merge sort, which is if I have two sorted arrays, independently sorted arrays, then how best I can merge the elements of these two arrays into another third resulting array, which still retains the overall ascending or descending order. Of course, that can be done, but how can it be done in minimal amount of time? And in general, what is the time, execution time that we'll have to spend? How many operations we'll have to do? So we'll discuss that. After discussing that problem, we'll move over to the discussion of another important data structure, which is available in C++, namely multidimensional arrays. We'll specifically look at matrices, because that is what we have to deal with in most of our computational problems in science and engineering. We'll take an example of solving a system of simultaneous equations, which is something which is commonly known to all of you. We'll look at the mechanism of representing such a system of simultaneous equations using matrices, and we'll then look at how such a system can be solved by one of the well-known methods, which is called Gauss elimination. You might not have studied Gauss elimination technique, but you would have studied matrices, right? You're familiar with the matrix, matrix multiplication, etc., etc., matrix representation of numbers, fine. So this is roughly what we are going to discuss today. We begin our discussion with the problem of merging contents of two sorted arrays. So here is a problem. I have an array T1 which contains 7 elements. 15, 11, 9, 8, 6, 2, 1. They are sorted in descending order. There is another array T2 which contains 4 elements, 12, 5, 4, 3. Again, T2 is also sorted in descending order of values. It so incidentally happens that in these two arrays, the numbers that you see, the values that you see, are actually unique values across both the arrays. It is not necessary. After all, there could have been 15, 11, 9, 9, 8, 6, 6, 2, etc. So the same value can recur. Just as in case of marks for students, there could be several students scoring the same marks. And if that happens, then their relative position in an array does not count really. I mean, somebody may be a third element, fourth element, fifth element, but as far as ranking is concerned, all of them will be considered to hold the same rank. So as long as they remain sorted in that descending or ascending order, we call that array as a sorted array. Our ambition is that we want to construct an array R which will contain elements from both these arrays, but which itself will be in the descending order of element values. So consider now the job of how will you do that. Imagine these are the arrays in which case the index of this element will be 0, index of this element will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. the index of these elements in array T2 will be only 0, 1, 2, 3. There are less elements. In general, consider that one array has say m elements totally and the other array has n elements. It is obvious that the resultant array R will have m plus n elements. What is the best way of getting the results into array R? If you want to scan any array T1 or T2, you would set up an iteration which will move some index value from 0 to m minus 1. This array can be spanned by moving an index from 0 to n minus 1. However, you will notice that you don't want to scan a complete array because the values that you will have to put in the result are here cannot be decided a priori by looking at all the elements of any one array. You have to actually look at elements in each of these arrays, keep comparing them. Whichever is the larger element you want to push into array R, and then move over to the next element of that array for comparison. In short, you need to set up an iteration which will actually move an index for array T1 and another index of array T2 in an asynchronous fashion. They will not neither move from 0 to m minus 1 and 0 to n minus 1 one at a time, nor they will move 0 here, 0 here, 1 here, 1 here, 2 here, 2 here, because at any point in time, you will notice that you will be comparing different elements of these two arrays to decide which one goes into R. Consequently, we decide on an index variable, let's say k. This variable k will denote the index for T1. Let's take another variable, say L, which will denote the variable, index variable which will scan T2. We will start with k equal to 0. And L equal to 0. What will index R? It can be neither k nor L. We require another index expression because R index is going to vary from 0 to m plus n minus 1. There are going to be larger elements in R. So let us decide that for R, we'll have another element, let's say J. J is also initially 0. Now what we are interested in, to figure out what happens to K, L and J, what should happen to K, L and J, and what should be the manner of pushing final result into array R. Consider this, when K is 0 and L is 0, I am essentially pointing to T1K will point here and T2L will point here. I am comparing 15 and 12. The larger of the two should go first into the element R. So larger of the two is 15. That means 15 should get into the array R as its first position. The moment 15 goes here, J should become 1 because next element is going to be element number 1. Should L change? L should not change because L has not moved yet. The element has not moved yet. What should change, however, is K. K should not now point to the next element. So K should become 1. This is the progression then, that if I have moved an array from T1, that means kth element I have moved to the corresponding element of R, then K should become 1 now. At any point in time, I will keep comparing kth element of T1 with lth element of T2. So if K is equal to 1 now, I compare 11 and 12. What do I find? Now 12 is greater. So obviously 12 should go into R, and the array from which an element goes to R, its index should be increased for next comparison. So I have here, after 15, I will get 12 here, and L will now become 1. In the next, and of course, J must also increase to 2. Now what am I comparing? I am comparing with 11 with 5 because both indexes are 1 and 1. Obviously, 11 is larger. 11 will move here, but index for this K will increase. Next time I will compare 9 and 5. 9 is larger, 9 will move here. The index of K will again increase to 8. It will again increase to 6. So observe that if I continue like this, the index for array T2 remains stagnant as long as I keep finding larger elements in array T1. Unless all of them are exhausted and are put into R, I am not going to change L. So what will I have here after 15, 12? I will have 11, which is the element of array T1. So K will now become 2. K2 will be compared here, 9 will be compared with 5. It is still greater, so I will have 9 here. Of course, this would have become 3. K will now become 3. I will look at value 8 here. 8 is again larger than 5, so I will push 8 here. This has of course changed to 4. I have got 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 elements here. The next value actually is 5, so J would actually have been set to 5, ready to receive a number. Now, T1, 3, which is 8, has been compared, so K should increase now to 4. So you notice that K and L are moving asynchronous. The moment K is equal to 4 and L is equal to 1, I am actually comparing the fourth element here with the element number 1 here, which is still 5. So that means I still have to push 6 here. When I push 6 here, this will increase to 6 and this will increase to 5. Now I look at the fifth element, which is 2. When I compare these 2 with 5, the index here is stagnant at this point. Now I notice that 5 is larger than 2. So this time I won't push the result from T1, but I'll push into result from T2. And this time, 5 will come out here. This of course will increase, but this time L will increase to 2. Notice that after 5, the next element is 4, which is larger than 2. So again, you will get 4 here, this will increase to 3. Then again, 3 is larger than 2, so you will get 3 here. Oh, I'm sorry, this will remain. You'll get 3 here and this will become 4. Is there a fourth element in T2? L has become 4 because I already compared the third element. I found the third element 3 to be larger than this element 2 and I have pushed this 3 out here. Technically, I should increase this and at any point I have to compare kth element of T1 and lth element of T2. Kth element of T1 is well defined, it is still 2. What is the lth element of T2? An element does not exist. Now if I write a general algorithm which will continue this till I have exhausted all m plus n elements, I will get into a problem here. Depending upon what arbitrary value happens to be in the memory location corresponding to the next element of this array, which is non-existent, that will get compared. The correct strategy to be used in such cases is called a strategy based on putting a sentinel value. I think I had used this term once. Sentinel is like a sentry or a watchman, which you keep on the door. The watchman decides who is permitted to go in and who is not permitted to go in. Or there could be at the exit point. This time we are talking about putting a sentinel value at the exit point such that our logical comparisons can continue. Imagine if I had some element value here which was guaranteed to be smaller than any possible element anywhere. It is an artificial value which I will insert. If I did that, then the comparison with the fourth element will proceed normally because there will be an element with index 4 here. Such an element which is artificially inserted, typically at the end of an array, to facilitate continued comparison with the index expressions that we count, are called sentinel elements. In this particular case, when we are talking about marks in an examination, and we generally presume that marks are not negative, in which case any negative number such as minus 999, arbitrary number, Suppose after reading the salted array, I inserted minus 999 myself as an artificial number in the next available element position. Now do you see that the proceedings will continue in a normal fashion? Because right now I have k is equal to 5, l is equal to 4, the element at index 5 is 2, the element at index 4 is now minus 999. And it so happens that 2 is greater than minus 999. In fact, that is why we have designed this value space. So this comparison, it will say this is larger, and what will happen now? 2 will get into the result area. So I get 2 here, and I increase the value of k to 6. I take the sixth element. Sixth element is 1, which is also larger than minus 999. So I will get 1 here. This will become 7. But by this time, the index j, which we have completely forgotten, would have increased every time I insert something into this array. So this would have become what? Yes? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 itself means 11 elements have gone in. 11 is the index. The moment I reach 11 index, I know already that I have exhausted all the valid elements of T1 and T2 because there were 7 elements here and 4 elements here. That is a terminal condition I get. I need not carry on beyond a value of j which is equal to or greater than m plus l because there is nothing to be compared. Doesn't this indicate a simple logic then? I scan the two arrays asynchronously, associating one index with one array, another index with another array, keep moving, comparing the corresponding elements indicated by those index values. At any time I find a value larger, I push it into the result and move the index one more. I keep doing this asynchronously for both the arrays and I keep repeating it. Every time I put an element into result R, and I will put one element in result R in every iteration, one of the larger. And whenever I have finished m plus n elements, I will just get out. The total time and effort that I will spend will be proportional to m plus n because I am executing an iteration only m plus n times. There are no nested iterations here like what we saw in sorted array. There is only one thing. I must be able to find a sentinel value. We are discussing now situations where the actual values in array are defined over certain domain, in which case any value which is legal but outside that domain can be taken to be sentinel. And depending upon whether we are finding out maximum or minimum, the last value can be appropriately adjusted. However, if the arrays contain all possible legal values, then it is not possible for us to consider an artificial sentinel value. We shall see what is to be done in such cases. We shall see what is to be done in such cases. However, for the purposes of illustration and for most of the practical problems, this sentinel strategy will work. It so happened that in this case, the last element of array T2 happened to be larger than one or more last elements of array T1, and therefore we needed a sentinel here. But we don't know the actual data values. It could be any which way. The best way then is that read both the arrays and push a sentinel value as the last plus one element in both the array. And then it does not matter whichever is encountered first, you will actually do the computations correct. So is this process understood? It's a very simple technique. In a single iteration, okay, which is executed m plus n times, you compare corresponding elements of these two arrays and decide which one to push. So this is a program to merge two sorted arrays. The program says that input is two arrays, T1 and T2. T1 has m elements, T2 has n elements. And arrays are of course assumed to be sorted. The result array R, which will contain sorted elements. That is roughly what the program is supposed to do. Let us look at the declarations. I am again arbitrarily assuming that there are 100 elements in T1, 100 elements in T2. It could be 1,000, it could be 1,000,000, As a matter of fact, the extension which I am going to ask you to work out, you will have probably millions of elements in the array. M and N are maximum numbers. I am arbitrarily assuming P to be the maximum number of elements in R, which will be simply M plus N. Arrays hold sorted numbers in descending order. This observation, I make it here. This should have been made here or there, because that will decide your comparison. And of course, I have integer variables K, L, M, I, J, etc., which I will use for either reading the arrays in or for my logic of the main iteration. This entire slide is about reading the input properly. So I ask user to give number of elements in first array. I read M, then I ask him to give individual elements, and I read T1i for I equal to 0 to M. So this kind of iteration is very common, by the way. Counting iteration for I equal to 0 to M minus 1. Notice it is I less than M. If you put I less than equal to M, you will get one extra number unnecessary. So you put this iteration, and generally if there is one element, one instruction, you can write it without braces. But as I have said, it is good practice to write braces here, because you are reading a value and you are also outputting a value. Notice that because this will be done iteratively, you will be putting those values one after another. And if you just put a cout statement T1i, then those values will get clobbered up and you will not be able to distinctly read those values on the output. Invariably then, when you are putting out element values in an iteration, it is good practice to put that element value and put one blank space or two blank spaces after that, so that the next element, when it is printed two spaces away and whatever. Just pretty printing. Notice that after having read elements from 0 to m minus 1, I am actually pushing a sentinel value in mth element. I am calling it a sentinel value. I put an end of line and continue doing exactly the same work for reading values of elements of array T2. So you can see there are a lot of instructions that you have to write. All of them amount to a simple thing. You are collecting the data from the user and putting it in appropriate arrays. Now, the main algorithm. Interestingly, the main algorithm actually is very short. It implements what we just discussed, the process that we just discussed. So let us analyze this. You remember the logic that we used? We start with values of K, L, and J as 0, 0, 0. I am using a do-while iteration. The do-while iteration forces at least one iteration, and then it will examine the condition at the end. If the condition is true, it will continue iterating as long as the condition is true. That's why it says do this. That means keep doing this while this condition is true. Notice the condition first. Do this again and again. How long? While J is less than or equal to M plus N. It's obvious to you why this is the condition. Because once I have collected M plus N elements, there is nothing more to be done. There are M elements in T1, N elements in T2. What am I doing inside? Simple, exactly the same logic that we used while looking at the explanation of the algorithm. I compare T1K and T2L. If T1K is greater than T2L, then T1K element should go into the results. That is what I am doing. I am assigning RJ to T1K and I am increasing K. If on the other hand this is not so, then T2L must go into RJ and L is incremented. So if this, then push from T1, else push from T2. But in either case, notice that this ends here, in either case, increment J. Because after having assigned one element to R, next time when I come back, I must assign the element to the next position of R. The most important point being made in this extremely simple and straightforward algorithm is that the index values for your arrays need not always move synchronously or need not always complete an iteration from 0 to m minus 1 or 0 to n minus. That is what you have done so far in all your iteration setting. This is an example where you are scanning three arrays actually. Two arrays you are scanning for looking at the elements and deciding on which element to push into R, you are scanning effectively the third array R. And each of the index value is moving is a pointer which is moving at different elements at different points. But I hope you will agree that this algorithm is quite simple and elegant, and this will achieve the purpose. So at the end, I have here some output now. The resulting array contains how many elements? 0 to m plus n minus 1. That is why you start the iteration from j equal to 0, end it for j less than m plus n. And you just output rj with some blank, so you will get the series of elements in R. Here is the sample execution of this merge program. So I compile it with C++. You remember the input redirection that we have discussed? Instead of typing the values of elements of array every time I run a program, I have put the array elements of the two arrays, including the number of elements, in a text file, which is called sorted_arrays.txt. And actually, the program is reading automatically from that file. However, the program will religiously execute cin and cout statements. Cout statements will come out on the screen. Cin statements will read from that file. So what you will see here is still the net effect, as if you had typed the data from your keyboard. No difference. So here are the two arrays. The first array, which has 7 elements, the second array, which has 4 elements, and the resulting array contains this. This is exactly what we expect. Now the point. This is an illustration which works for 7 and 4 elements. Is there any reason to assume it will not work for 600 and 600 elements? The logic is exactly same. Is there any reason to assume why it will not work for 10,000, 10,000 elements, or 1 million, 1 million elements? Now we come back, I will make some comment on the notion of merge sort. The sorting algorithm that we had discussed, if you remember, we had executed that program for, let's say, 25,000 students, 50,000 students, and 1 lakh students by artificially generating the data. And we had observed that the execution time was increasing in proportion to the square of the size of the problem. Suppose I have n students. Instead of sorting the data for n students in a single algorithm, I divided those n students into 2 arrays, their marks I mean. I am doing artificial data generation, so I could do the following. I could define such 2 arrays, marks 1 something, marks 2 something, or whatever. T1 and T2. And I could, when I am artificially generating data for, let's say, 1 lakh students, I will put mark 1 here, mark 2 there, mark 3 here, 4 there, 5 there, 6 there, etc. I can arbitrarily distribute data in any which way into these 2 arrays. Now I can apply that sort algorithm to work on half the data. If my data is half, the time will be 1/4. I got now 2 arrays sorted, and if I now merge them, the merging is not proportional to nested iteration timing. It is a single linear search. You will agree then that breaking a large array into 2 parts, sorting them individually, and then merging them like this is likely to be much faster. In the next class, I will show you an example of that. But extend the same logic further. If I have 1 million records to sort, why break it only in 5 lakhs and 5 lakhs? I can break it into 4 different arrays. I can break it into 8 different arrays. The general algorithm is called K-way merge. It is not a very simple logic, because to write multiple arrays and to maintain those multiple arrays will make your program clumsy. Later on, much later in the class, we will see that this data will not be neatly available in your memory. In fact, much of the larger data is available in disk files. And sorting is most pertinent when it is done on large data residing on your disk files, which cannot be accommodated in the memory. Most of the real life sorting and searching is done on data which is located on the disk files, not in the memory. Of course, you need to bring that data into memory to process anything. So you'll be reading the data from the file just as you are doing it now. We shall study those algorithms post-mid-sem. But you agree that the simple technique of merging is a fairly powerful technique, and if used in conjunction with the salting that we have studied, it could yield significantly faster results for salt. The general name for such algorithms which mix merging and salting is the merge salt algorithm. There are many types of algorithms, some of them we'll look at later, but most of them would be studied as a specialized branch of algorithms. Mostly computer science students study them, but all others who do a whole lot of computations involving large data might want to look at those as well. Okay, with this, we now go over to the discussion on multidimensional arrays. Just as we have declared one-dimensional array and used it, we can actually declare a two-dimensional array and use it, a three-dimensional array and use it. Two-dimensional array is something which is quite familiar to us, which is what we call a matrix. The way an array is declared for two dimensions is you simply add one more pair of square brackets and put the size of the second dimension here. So just as A50 would have meant an array of 50 elements, A50-40 means an array A which logically has 50 rows and 40 columns. So you have 2000 elements declared there. Naturally, you would like to know how do you access individual elements, because those are the ones which will participate in any operation, in any expression, in any assignment. So each element is accessed by a reference requiring two indexes. If you have a five-dimensional array, you will require five indexes. Each index is written in a separate bracket. For example, A, I, J. It means first a dimension is indexed by I, second dimension is indexed by J. There is no harm. You can say A, I, I. If you did that, and if you imagine the two-dimensional array to be a matrix, A, I, I will denote what? The diagonal element. So you have a logical reference frame in your mind, because a matrix you can sort of imagine before your eyes. And you get a two-dimensional array to be exactly same as matrix. The number of dimensions in C++ are not limited. They are limited only by the total memory that you have for allocation. In general, you would not require more than three or four dimensional arrays in most of the complex computational problems as well. Note that the row index I can have a value from 0 to 49 if the size is declared as 50. Because the array index always begins with 0 and ends at 1 less than the size. Note also that like in the n-dimensional array, the size of the array in the original declaration must be a constant value. It cannot be an expression. You can't say array m, n. There is no such meaning, because m and n are variables whose values are not known to the compiler. You will read M and N later in your program maybe. But compiler has to allocate memory locations to that array when it is compiling, not when the program is executing. So variable values or expressions cannot be used to declare sizes of the array. Much later, we shall see how memory can be allocated dynamically while the program is executing. But as of now, we'll just go by the rules of array declarations. Arrays must be declared with absolute sizes declared at the time of their appearance in the program. And all rules for index expression apply for index of each dimension. Namely, any index can be a complex expression, I plus 4 into j minus x plus y, whatever, whatever. The entire expression is evaluated, value is converted to an integer, and it is that integer value which is used. If that integer value lies within the limits that you have prescribed, such as 0 to 49 and 0 to 39 here, then of course you are accessing a meaningful element of that two-dimensional array. If that value lies outside, you don't know what will happen. The results are unpredictable. C++ takes no responsibility for handling such things. Equipped with this, equipped with the multidimensional array structure, which is very similar to what we have seen here, we can note a couple of points immediately when we see this. If I were to scan all elements of a single dimensional array which had, let's say, m elements, I would run an iteration for I equal to 0, I less than m, I plus plus, and access each element in sequence. But if I want to access all the elements of a two-dimensional array, I will require a nested iteration. For I equal to 0, I less than M, I plus plus. Inside, for J equal to 0, J less than N, J plus plus. And inside that, I will do whatever I want to do with A, I, J. And that will be covering all the elements. Imagine the first dimension to represent rows, second dimension to represent columns, and what you have is a matrix representation of your data. We shall use that matrix representation to look at a problem which is quite important in most scientific and engineering computations, namely that of solving simultaneous equations. These arise in many cases. Consider these two equations, 2x plus 4y equal to 8 and 4x plus 3y equal to 1. You will agree that these equations in x and y in a normal plane will represent two lines. The intersection of those two lines will actually be the solution of these two equations. That is one case where you want to solve equations. When you go further, deeper into the computational problems in, say, mechanical engineering, aerospace engineering, civil engineering, chemical engineering, where you are simulating a large plant with large number of different elements doing different processing, you will have to represent or model real life situations by an extraordinarily large number of simultaneous equations, or later even simultaneous differential and partial equations. There is no way you could solve them analytically. You will have to solve them numerically. One method that we are going to look at attempts to solve such simultaneous equations numerically. So we will just revisit this example. Is well known. Everybody knows exactly how you solve such problems. All of you have solved a 2x2 set of equations sometime or the other, manually. Okay. How many of you have solved a set of 4 equations in 4 variables? 1, 2. How many have done that for 10 equations in 10 variables? Nobody. And we are talking about engineering and scientific computations involving 100 by 100 equations. The point I am trying to make is, there is no way some of these problems could even be attempted without some computational tool. However, since all of you have done a 2x2 solution, let us very quickly revisit the process that you use. You effectively do what? You add, subtract these equations, you multiply some equation by something, subtract it from something else. Effectively, you want to eliminate one of the two variables, get the value of the second variable, put that back into the first equation, the other equation, and find out the value of the second. What I want to do now is to go through the process rather methodically, citing algebra rules which are to be deployed in order to provide that process. So first, we will look at the matrix representation of these equations. All that we do is we take up the coefficients of unknown variables x and y, 2, 4, 4, 3, put them in a matrix. These are unknown variables x and y, so I put them here. I'm sorry. Yeah, x and y here. And then this is the right hand side, 8 and 1. Are you familiar with this representation of a 2x2 equation like this? You can easily make sense, because this in a matrix sense means 2 times x plus 4 times y equal to 8, and 4 times x plus 3 times y equal to 1. Very simple. What do we do with this representation now? First, we look at what do we do with those equations. We want to solve those equations. The method that we actually follow depends upon certain standard facts which govern the set of simultaneous equations. If you call that a system, then the system is not affected if an equation is multiplied by a constant. So this is actually a hard provable theory, that if you take an equation multiplied by a constant on both left and right hand side, it does not constitute new information in that system. It is unaffected. The system is unaffected. So suppose I do that and I multiply this first equation by 0.5. I am getting here 1x plus 2y equal to 4. I call it equation 1 dash. Is this 0.5 an arbitrary value? It appears to be arbitrary value, but if we notice what is the effect in equation 1, the coefficient of x has become 1. So we are trying to get on the diagonal elements a coefficient 1. That is the objective, as we shall see in the more general case. So what have we multiplied this equation with? We have multiplied this equation with some value which depends on the coefficient of the first element. This was 2, so we multiplied by 0.5, equally divided by 2, that's all. And we got this equation. So this, we have utilized one fact. There is another fact. Of course, when I represent these equations in the matrix form, I now get 1, 2, 4, 3 as my matrix here. And simultaneously, I get 4, 1 as my right-hand side array. So notice that by applying this logic, I am changing the contents of this matrix and I am simultaneously changing the contents of the right-hand side array. X, Y, of course, is unknown, so I don't do any processing there. The original coefficients were 2, 4, 4, 3, and the new coefficients are 1, 2, 4, 3. Now I apply the second important fact. Namely, if an equation is replaced by a linear combination of itself and any other row, again, the system is not affected. Now, I do not know in which way you have learned this, but this is a basic fact of algebra in terms of simultaneous equations in multiple unknowns. In fact, when you want to eliminate x or y in two equations, what do? You multiply one equation by some value and subtract or add it to another equation. What you are doing is you are generating a linear combination of these two equations. And the fact that is important, why you get right solutions, is because a linear combination of any two equations does not change the system. The system remains same. So this is an important fact here. And using that, we replace the second equation, which was 4x plus 3y equal to 1. So we want to replace equation 2 by subtracting from it 4 times the first equation. What is the reason? This has a coefficient 4, this has a coefficient 1. If I multiply this by 4 times and then subtract it from here, the coefficient of x will be 0. That means x will be eliminated in the resulting equation. That is the process that we use for solving. If I did that, then from these coefficients, which was equation 1 dash and equation 2, I multiply equation 1 dash by 4 and I get this. 1, 2, 0, minus 5, x, y, 4, minus 15. Notice that what was 1 becomes minus 15 now and what was 3 becomes minus 5 now. This happens because of the linear combination that I make. Most important, the coefficient of x is 0. Such matrices are useful because I have eliminated one of the variables here. I still haven't got the final solution. I will go one step further. I will further multiply the second equation, equation 2 dash, by minus 0.2. Where do I get this minus 0.2 from? Notice that the coefficient of y here is minus 5. Can you see this? Minus 5. Now, I want to find out the value of y. Ideally, I would like the coefficient of y to be 1. To make it 1, which is minus 5, if I multiply it by minus 0.2, I will get a coefficient 1y. Now, you will notice that the matrix which I started with, which was a proper 2 by 2 matrix, is now reduced to a form where I have 1 on the main diagonal and 0 in the lower part, non-zero values in the upper part. Such matrices are called upper triangular matrices. And one of the great advantages, one of the great advantages of upper triangular matrices is they actually yield the results when put in the context of simultaneous equations. Why? From the last equation, directly get the value of y. Using that value of y and substituting it in the previous expression, I will get the value of x. And I can repeat this process any number of times. I can have hundreds of variables, it does not matter. So starting from the last equation and using back substitution, we get the solution for all variables. Well, what we have discussed is nothing but the Gauss elimination technique. So, in short, the Gauss elimination technique uses certain standard facts of algebra, two facts actually. One is you can multiply an equation by any constant, and second is if you make a linear combination of two equations, that means multiply one equation by some value and subtract it from another equation, the system of linear equations remains same. And we use these facts to successively do the following. One, we get the diagonal element of the first row, that is 1, 0, 0, to be 1. And then below that we want to assure that everything is 0. We do the same thing for all diagonals. If we succeed in doing that, we can apply this back substitution and get results. This was a 2 by 2 example, but it could be a 100 by 100 matrix. The same logic will apply. So this is the essence. I want to get an upper triangular matrix with all elements of diagonal as 1 and then use back substitution. The entire Gauss elimination technique can be written in just these three lines. That's the essence. Okay. Now we want to write a program to do that. We will not notice it in the small examples that we will try, but in real life, the coefficients will be all floating point numbers, by the way. They are not nice integer values. They're complex. I mean, they're not complex, they're floating point numbers where the precision matters. When you do this kind of processing, multiply a row by some value, subtract the corresponding elements between two rows and so on, you are susceptible to round off errors. And the errors may blow out of proportion when you have a very large system of equations. That is practical fact. We are not able to notice that now. But having noticed that, the scientists who worked on the numerical analysis algorithms evolved many other alternative, stronger processes. Some of the names I have mentioned here. For example, Gauss-Jordan elimination. Rather than just Gauss elimination, you have a slightly modified elimination technique. There is a notion of pivoting, there is a notion of partial pivoting. There is another method called LU decomposition, and in fact, a large number of such methods. The simultaneous equations which arise in real life are not very straightforward like these 2 by 2 equations that we saw. You may have an overdetermined set of equations. Have you heard of overdetermined set of equations? You have 50 unknown variables, but you have 100 equations. Which of these 100 do you choose will decide how accurate your final result would be. You might have an underdetermined set of equations. You have 20 variables, but only 18 independent equations. Somebody gives you 25 equations and say choose any, but you suddenly find that some of those equations are already some linear combination of some other equations. Then they are useless. They don't represent any new independent information. So in real life, there are lots of complications there. We're not going to discuss those. Our ambition right now is to discuss the programming of Gauss elimination technique. How do we write a program to get the Gauss? This is a useful reference. I think I had mentioned this once. Numerical Recipes, an extremely powerful book. Anybody who has to do with numerical analysis in the future course of action in your own field should actually own one book like. The first book was published called Numerical Recipes in Fortran. Many of you would have just heard of Fortran. Fortran was the first higher level language ever defined in the world of computers. It was designed in 1956 by a group of 6 people, 3 from IBM and 3 for the users of IBM. IBM is a well-known company, you heard the name, I guess. In 50s and 60s, all the computers ever manufactured in the world, half of them were manufactured by IBM. So IBM was the strongest player in the field of computers then, and a lot of important and useful research has come out of IBM initiative. Fortran was one higher level language which came out of that. Of course, later on when C and C++ became popular for computational purposes, the same authors have written a book in Numerical Recipes in C. And now they have written another book called Numerical Recipes in C++. And when I say now, it is quite some few years ago. It's an extremely interesting book, good book, and it discusses a whole lot of problems, including the problems of errors that may crop up due to the floating point, round off, and such things that happen. This is the general representation of n variables. So if I have linear equations in n variables, I could describe them like this. An n by n matrix, a set of n independent variables x1, x2, xn, and right hand side b1 to bn. We note, however, that this may be the mathematical notation that we follow, but in C++, unfortunately, our indexes do not start with 1. They start with 0 and they go up to n minus 1. So our representation we may be better off if we write it like this: a00, a01, a02, a0, n minus 1, etc. We will use this representation. The independent variables will use the notation 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. There are no values here. This will be actually the result that we will get. Okay. But we will have all the values of the coefficients here and all the values of the right hand side. Using these two, n by n array and another n element one dimensional array, we need to find out values of the independent variables. This is the general representation of the result that we wish to achieve after applying Gauss elimination. As I mentioned, Gauss elimination gives us the coefficients matrix in an upper triangular form. All elements on the diagonal are 1, all elements below this are 0, and there are of course non-zero elements here. And the method of finally finding the solution is back substitution. So I will find xn minus 1 first. Substituting that in the previous expression, I will find xn minus 2, xn minus 3 till I find x0. What is the process of getting this in the upper triangular form? We generalize the process that we saw for the 2 by 2 matrix. It is clear that I need to handle all the n by n elements here, so I will require a nested iteration. It is best that I start with the first row. So my top iteration will begin from I equal to say 0 to n minus 1. Now when I am having one value of I, let's say I is equal to 0, I will concentrate on this column. For I equal to 0, the first thing that I do is I get this coefficient to be 1. Note that at that point in time, all these coefficients will be non-zero based on the input that you have given. So while I is 1, I will move j from 0 plus 1 to n minus 1, going over this value. And what will I do? I will take the j equal to 1 row and ensure that by linear combination I make this into 0 and I change the corresponding values here. I do the same thing for the right hand side for b1. While I is still 1, I will make j equal to 2 now. And I will do the same thing with second row, j equal to 3, j equal to 4, j equal to n minus 1. In short, when my I is 1, I would have handled all the equations once by getting 1 in the major diagonal here for 0, 0, and by putting all of these as 0. Now I gracefully go to I equal to 1. So I increment I. That means from the 0th row, I go to the first row. I don't have to do anything here. This is in the final form. When I come here, I do the same thing for the I comma ith element, which is now 1 comma 1 element. I make that 1 by appropriate multiplication here and eliminate all the coefficients below this. So this time I will have to run my iteration for j equal to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 to n 1. When I becomes 2 and I come here, I will have to do it for j equal to 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I have a nested iteration. And the logic is very straightforward, exactly the same thing I have to do. The number of elements, the number of rows that I look at for any one value of I will keep decreasing one by one till I go to the last row. If this is the simple logic, the implementation should also not be very complicated. In general, we represent the system of n equations like this. In terms of the coefficients that we are now talking about, dimensional array and the one dimensional B matrix, we will be representing our equations as x0 plus a01 x1 plus a0n minus 1 xn minus 1 etc. is equal to b0. And so we are saying this is the upper triangular form in which the coefficient of x0 is 1, the coefficient of x1 is 1 in the second equation, and so on, and the coefficient of xn minus 1 is 1 in the last equation. This is the form which we have to get. Originally, when I read the n by n matrix called A or coefficient matrix, whatever, I would have, of course, non-zero elements anywhere. We go back to our example, 2x plus 4y equal to 8 and 4x plus 3y equal to 1. And we notice that we represent x by x0 and y by x1. We will have this kind of coefficient matrix where the coefficients are 2, 4, 4, 3, b0 is 8, b1 is 1. That's our representation. And we can solve this problem getting the same values of x0 and x1. This is the program. Again, I am sticking to my arbitrary number 100. I have an equation set which is 100 by 100 equations, 0 to 99, 0 to 99. This is the matrix B, which is the right hand side. X is unknown. Okay. So I will have to find my results in the array X. I am declaring I, J, K as variables that I will use for indexing purposes. N apparently is the size of the array. I am using additional variables which I am defining, such as divisor. You can guess where I will use that divisor? To make the coefficient 1, I will have to take that coefficient value and divide all elements of that row by that value. Because when x I becomes 1, all other element coefficients will also change. So I will use that as a divisor. Where will I use a factor? For any row where I want to eliminate a particular variable and make it 0, I have to multiply that by a factor and subtract it from the equation. The factor will change for every row. So I have another variable called factor. And of course, I will have to calculate sum of partially determined variable values when I do back substitution. So I have this variable. You will find that you can easily identify the objectives of these variables and array elements in your program. This again is the routine, unnecessary work, not unnecessary, necessary work which you have to compulsorily do, input and output, consumes non-trivial efforts. So I run a nested iteration for I equal to 0 to n minus 1, j equal to 0 to n minus 1. I read all elements of matrix A. Of course, I have first read n. I read similarly matrix B, which has 0 to n minus 1 elements, so n elements again. This is the Gauss elimination. So let us look at the Gauss elimination carefully. As I told you, I have to have an outer iteration. So I start with I equal to 0 to n minus 1. Now I am on the ith row. It incidentally I is 0 at the beginning, but it does not matter. At any point in time, I am at the ith row. At the ith row, I divide each row by the coefficients on the diagonal. So divisor is mat A, I, comma I. Once I divide the entire row by mat I, comma I, the coefficient of x I, comma I will be 1. So I don't need to do that division. I set it explicitly to 1. There is a point here. Sometimes the computations that you get may not yield exact result. So wherever you know what is the result, like a 0 or 1, it is best to force it. Okay. So I am setting that to 1. Now I calculate all coefficients in that row. So if I am on the ith row, then the subsequent elements are I plus 1 to n minus 1. And each element I will divide by this divisor. So whatever is the element in that row, I am dividing by divisor and replacing that. I have taken care of the ith row at this juncture. I have got 1 in the I comma ith element and I have appropriately changed all the other coefficients. But I should not forget the right hand side fellow. The right hand side element also must be divided by the same divisor. So therefore I normalize the corresponding RHS element by dividing ith element of B by the same divisor. So this part of the program has taken care of ith row of my Gauss elimination process. Now I have to take care of all rows below ith row and to ensure that I get zeros below that I comma I element. This is done by this part of the program, where it says that we replace subsequent rows by subtracting the appropriate portion of iron patient from that row. And what is the appropriate portion? Whatever is the coefficient of xi in that row, because the coefficient of ii is 1, I have set it to 1. So what is the coefficient there? That is the multiplying factor. I multiply the ith row by that factor and subtract, I will get 0 there. So that is why I first calculate the factor. Now, I want to move from k equal to I plus 1 to less than n. So k now is a variable which scans my subsequent rows below I. Of course, I do not want to do this endlessly. So how long will I do it? As long as I plus 1 is less than n. After all, if I have reached my last row and I have made that coefficient 1, there is nothing below it. So I don't have to do anything there. I calculate this factor, and because of this factor, I know that the kth row ith column element is going to be 0, because after subtraction. So I set it to 0. But remaining coefficients I calculate. So I multiply kth row jth column and subtract from it the factor times ith row jth column. That is the linear combination. So what I am doing is I am calculating linear combination for j equal to I plus 1 to n minus. So I have ith row. I am now looking at the kth row. In the kth row, from I plus 1, I plus 2, I plus 3, up to the last element, I have to do this linear combination. This is what it does. And at the end then, I calculate the right hand side, which is the kth element of B, has to be again subtracted from the ith element of B multiplied by appropriate factor. So you agree that this implements the Gauss technique of eliminating? And if I go through all the values of I, j and k, I would have in the end obtained my matrix in the desired upper triangular form. All that I need to do now is to do back substitution. So I start with x n minus 1, which is simply the right hand side n minus 1th value. And for I equal to n minus 2 to 0, I go backward now. For every row, I find the sum of the remaining elements using values of x which I already found out. And using this back substitution, I calculate sum in this iteration. And I simply say xi is equal to bi minus sum. This will get me the remaining elements. So this is clear how exactly the matrix multiplication will work. You may want to go back and examine the variation in the various indexes I, j, k, and make sure that the process is followed correctly. This algorithm is correct because I have tested it. Of course, I produced the output just as I had one page of instructions for input, I have another page of instructions for output. So I'll produce matrix A, matrix B, and I will put the result. This facility we already discussed, but I am just including it in the slides for the sake of completion. Whenever I execute a program, I have to keep giving data again and again and again, particularly when I am trying out to debug that program. And if I have a large amount of data that is required for every execution, it is cumbersome to type that data every time I execute my program. And therefore, I use redirection. By that, I put the data in some file and use a symbol less than. This is the formal way of defining that redirection. So whenever we execute C in, what happens is the data is collected from your keyboard. Every operating system has a feature by which you can tell the operating system that, look, when you run this program, don't read the input from keyboard, but instead read it from a file. Similarly, you can also tell the operating system that when you produce the output, don't produce the output on my screen, but produce it in a file so that I can later on also examine that file. This is called input and output redirection. In Unix, it is done simply by using a less than symbol immediately after the program name. So you say dot slash a dot out less than some file name. Immediately from this point onwards, all your CN statements will be executed by reading values from this file. So this file should better contain values in the proper format which are required as input for your program. In exactly the similar way, you can create an output instead of a terminal, you can create it to some file. if a file by the same name exists earlier, it will be demolished and rewritten. So if you want to generate outputs for different runs with different input, better give different file names for your output file. You can of course use both of them simultaneously. So this is a perfectly valid command. /a.out less than input data dot text greater than output data file dot text. The names of files are your choice. They can be any names which are permitted in C++ system. So this I guess is known. I would like you to start using it. Even in the labs I have seen that whenever you execute a program you type your values. Perhaps because there are few values it does not matter. But imagine if you have to give 12 values for every execution and there are 5 iterations, 5 runs of the program that you require before you debug it. It is not worthwhile to type those values 12 times, so or 5 times. So you might put them in a file and do that. This is the sample input data file, coefs.txt. I will upload all these files in the Gauss program onto Moodle so that you can read that. These are the input values, the 4x4 matrix, coefficient matrix. This is the right hand side matrix, -3, 3, 4, 6. This is the result. So when I execute that, I redisplay the coefficient matrix and the values of the variables which are calculated as 1, 2, 3, 4. Observe some idiosyncrasies of Cout. When you use Cout to print values, it does not print it in a manner which is easy reading for the human eyes. For example, it will print 0.5 here, but the corresponding value here is 1. So it will print the next value 1.4 immediately here. It will not align it in any way. It will rather keep printing values. Whatever space that value requires, after that it will print the next value. So this is not very pretty printing. Ideally, the way we would like our output would be something like this. Doesn't this look better? You have all the coefficients in an organized fashion. Unfortunately, it is very difficult to control such output using Cout. You can. We will study that, particularly when we look at Cout and the less operator in the context of the formal object-oriented framework of C++ and study a whole lot of settings of the output field widths and so on, we'll see that. The traditional way, however, in proper printing and similarly in proper interpretation of input data is to use 2 standard built-in functions into the C++ library which come from the C standard library actually. One is called printf, which is used to print properly in a formatted way any output, and the other is called scanf. We are not going to discuss those functions now. We'll do that after mid-sem. We'll continue to use cin and cout statements. So this is just an indication that there is something inadequate here. That's it I have. Thank you.